அனைவருக்கும் வணக்கம். ஒன்ஸ் அகேன் சர்வ கிருஷ்ணா கிருஷ்ணார்த்தமஸ்து என்று முடிப்பது வழக்கம். இந்த பிரசன்டேஷனை பிஹெச்டி அர்ப்பணமஸ்து என்று துவக்குகிறேன். மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் த லாஸ்ட் ஃபியூ வீக்ஸ் பிரசன்டேஷன்ஸ் ஹவ் பீன் விஷுவல் ட்ரீட்ஸ் இன்க்ளூடிங் டுடேஸ், பட் திஸ் பிரசன்டேஷன் வில் பி அ வர்பல் டெசிபல் பொம்பார்ட்மெண்ட். நித்ராதேவி இமைகளில் நடனமாடாமல் இருக்கட்டும். The topic of today's presentation is commerce, coins, taxation and law in imperial Chola times. குறைகள் இருப்பின் என்பால் உடைத்து, நிறைகள் யாவும் பின்காணும் குருமார்களுக்கு உருத்தாகிய. So these are all the reference thing I have referred to these people, many of the things. Imperial Cholas built up their empire covering most of South India, parts of Odisha and Bengal, Sri Lanka and Maldives and Southeast Asian nations at their peak. Rule for almost 420 years. Only kingdom in the history is a question mark to have invaded and ruled over a foreign land. Significant advances were made in maritime technology, metalcraft, temple architecture, arts and administration. The result was multifold jump in the wealth of the kingdom. In the following presentation, an attempt is made. In the following presentation, an attempt is made just to have a glimpse at the economy and constituents that prevail at those times based on writings of eminent scholars. We will primarily cover commerce, that's mainly a business, coins, legal tenders, taxation, revenue, and law controls. Few assumptions and facts, some caveats have been considered. Chola Empire was in an expansion mode, more brutal in war, and plundered the wealth from conquered lands. Huge positive trade balances and wealth creation from internal and external trades. Use the wealth thus collected to create some of the artistic wonders of the world, like temples, water bodies, exquisite statues, jewelry, etc. Slavery existed in certain areas. To appreciate the size of the economy, let us do a thought exercise taking help from Dr. Angus Madison. Please don't take it very seriously, just an indication of the size of the economy. Like in 1000 CE, when the Chola Empire just started ascendancy, the Indian GDP was almost 28% of the world. Chola was about 27% of the Indian GDP. In 1250, where things have started going down for Chola, approximately it was again 27.7% Indian GDP and 30% was the Chola GDP. Why this 27%? As on today, the four southern states contribute 29.7% of Indian GDP of 2018. If we add this Odisha and Bengal, it will jump to about 39%. So naturally, you could have said South India enjoys the same status of GDP what it was existed in Chola time, just to indicate. Commerce. Chola country were divided into mandalams, nadus, nagarams, that is towns, Ur villages for administrative purpose. Every Nadu had many nagarams, that is towns, that were connected to surrounding villages. The engines of economic growth in Chola times, the first industry, weaving, was widespread. Both cotton cloth and silk were made. Traditional wares were made. When I say traditional wares, like dhoti, what it was as sarees and all those things. Family groups were in this, most important. The community of weavers were called Salians. The Salian is a name, very, very important one. I think it was prevailed all over South India. Even now, Mangalore area, there are people who have Salian Sarkas. That is the surname, they will have a Salian. All those people were in the weaving field. So it's about thousands of years it is continuing. Weaving industry was mostly town or temple centered. Separate settlements and streets were accorded for the weavers to carry out their production and trade. The industry was patronized by the royalty and accorded special privileges. Only selected Salia weavers were accorded the privilege of weaving garments for deities and royalty. I know turban making was considered a special status among them. Pattu Salians in Kanjipuram were administered to keep temple accounts. Jeevaka Chintamani refers to Pumpattu, Pachilaipattu, Venpattu, etc. It means when they were given asked to temple accounts, I think the status of weaving community, weavers were comparatively much higher than any other people.
I don't know.
The only one who knows about Pattu and all, he's following. Kanchi, Tanjavur, Madurai, Urayur, Arandangi, Kumbakonam, Kungunadi, etc. were major weaving centers. Rajaraja I, period inscription at Thiruvattur, mentions the Achutaris. The weaving centers of Andhra, Kalinga, Karnataka also were added to their kitty when they came under Cholas. Kaikolas, who were the bodyguards of kings, also engaged in weaving, making coarse cloth. One more. Kanjipuram emerged as the main weaving guild. This metal crafts, this became an art form under Cholas, has carved an unique and eternal place in Indian history. Use of utensils of silver, copper, brass for cooking and other household chores were common with the wealthy and royalty. Underline wealthy and royalty. Big temple inscriptions mention this. Kumbakonam was an important center. All big towns had facilities for manufacturing this category. Metal casting reached a high standard. Bronze statues, bells, metal lamps, icons were made for temples. Lost wax technique was perfected for casting main idols. Hollow casting technique was employed to make other parts like Thiruvasal, Pita, Vahana, etc. The special clay found on the Kaveri bed added to the exquisite quality of the statue. Swamimalai, Nachiyar Kovil, Tiruchirappalli were the most important centers. The fitness and refinement of features, the fineness and refinement of features are the hallmark of Chola bronzes. Second, jewelry was the most sought after item by all. Variety of ornaments in gold, silver, studded with precious stones, pearls, and exquisite designs were in great demand. The designs were most important. The designs were documented to reproduce later by anybody. Ornaments were worn by men also. Abdul Razak mentions, men wore jewels, ornaments in their ears, necks, hands, arms, wrists, and fingers. The third most important one, all hoarded the jewelry and took great care in preserving in spite of the loot by the invaders. Most of the jewelers lived in towns closer to the royalty and wealthy and near the temple. Temple jewelry, the category specialized by the jewelers, were mentioned inscriptions in big temple. The frescoes and murals in the temples depict the designs of the jewelry worn by gods, royalty, and commoners, and also the the wear of garments worn by them. See, these are all some of the, just to show the all of you would have. I wanted to add some visuals, so I brought this. Otherwise, it's such a the following figure. I mean, this always, I was very fascinated by that. All these things you find, the jewelries, what sort of jewelries are depicted in all these pictures. Fantastic. And this is one of the finest, this one. You can see all the dresses, text, what sort of, sartorial things were there those days. One can really understand from this. Forging of weapons and casting of armors for military purposes are another major industry. It seems these were state controlled, though not much is known about it. I tried to find out details, I couldn't find many. References to the presence of these at Vikramacholapuram, Kodumanal, Guttur, Bahur near Chengalpattu, etc. Because Cholas, they had such a massive raid all over the country. They should have so many people. They say 60,000 elephants, more than 2 lakh people going all around. Weaponry, how they manage this defense, this one, how they manage is a very, it's an intriguing question, how they manage to get all those stocks. And they say, I read somewhere this Chola weaponry, especially this curved sword, was a specialty of Cholas. And they also talks about wood sword, which was again considered people use from, even Iraq. This, again, this Hassan Ali, that one, the war was used, the Iraqis were using those swords, men from Chola times, woods. Wood steel, they say. Woods has come from Urk. All villages had blacksmiths, potters, carpenters, attending to the needs of farmers and households. As per Kulothunga I period record, blacksmiths were ordered to relocate to Punganur village. Salt manufacturing was widespread along coastal areas, were supervised and controlled by the state. Salt pans dotted across the coast of Marakkalam, Variyur, Kanyakumari, Thoothukudi, Vedaranyam, Repatla, and many more. The industry was a money spinner to the central and the local bodies. Pearl industry, most sought after by royalty and jewelers, adds value to the ornaments. Gulf of Mannar was the place hatchery happened. Large number of people were engaged in pearl fishing. Many small industries like smiths, pottery, brick kilns, and mat weaving, etc., catering to local needs, function in all the villages and towns. Women were employed mostly in mat weaving, pottery, and weaving. In metal casting, women were not involved, especially in bronze idol making. Next to agriculture, weaving industry employed most people of both genders. The high point of Chola state was the phenomenal advances made in commerce and consequently acquiring control over trade both inland and external beyond seas. An important outcome was the building of a large naval force, the first in India and by an Indian state, it's a question mark, it has to be, a strengthening maritime trade and spread of art and culture beyond seas. Internal trade. The types of items traded in Chola Empire, goods produced locally, that is in the Chola country, goods procured or moved or brought from states beyond, generally those under Chola suzerainty. The third, goods imported from other kingdoms and countries. Commodities sold off for common consumption were traded in villages, towns, and nagarams. Big towns and capital. They fall under aruvai, that is cloth, pon, gold, kula, grains, உப்பு சால்ட் எண்ணெய் ஆயில் கொலு க்ளோஸ் பனிட்டம் ஜாகிரி ஜுவல்லரி ஆர்னமெண்ட்ஸ் ப்ரீஷியஸ் ஸ்டோன்ஸ் பேர்ல் சில்க் கிளாத் உட்டன்சில்ஸ் ஸ்பைசஸ் பெர்ஃபியூம்ஸ் வேர் இன் டிமாண்ட் அண்ட் ட்ரேடட் இன் செப்பரேட் ஜோன்ஸ் ஆர் இன் ஸ்பெஷல் ஜோன் கூலம் கூலமா ஓகே ரைட் 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 கூலா இல்ல எம் மிஸ் ஆயிடு எம் மிஸ்
ஆயிடு
கூ ஆ ஓகே இங்கிலீஷ்ல போட்டிருக்கேன் நல்ல கூலம் கூலம் எம் மிஸ் ஆயிடு Spices, perfumes were in demand, traded in special zones. This is another important one. All towns, both big and small, had marked zones with streets to carry out the trade. Merchants carried out their business from their kadais, that is shops, and angadis, markets situated in big streets. Perundar, this is called Perundar. Now it also changes Periyathar. I think even now every town have a Periyathar. All old towns. This is the same system it's followed. Big traders were called Vyabarigal and smaller traders Vanigargal. See here also the slight distinction between the how they segregate. Wholesale markets function separately. There were the habit of naming markets after royalty. Tanjavur had Tribuna Madevi, Perangadi, Vanavan Madevi, Perangadi, Konganangadi, etc. String continues. Now, this is a very important one. Colored banners were displayed to indicate the nature of goods trade. This is another way of, you know, marketing, communication, marketing.
Just well before the time of
Cholas.
Imperial Cholas. Pretty much exactly the same model.
I think this has not changed at all. Even though you see, what trade, what procedures we had followed in commerce and trade has not changed at all, even not in spite of Western thinking. So this is a very, very important. Here they say, what I have here also, it is the same. China also, it is the same. Trading, China and India have not changed over the centuries. Chola land was divided into Mandalam, Nadu, Nagaram, Gramam. For administrative purposes, each Nadu has many nagarams which are connected to the surrounding villages. Nagaram anchored as the business center, and as the economy improved, paving way for urbanization. Mostly these nagarams developed around the temple, as it was the fulcrum of life. Nagaram emerged as the finance centers, warehousing centers, and distribution centers. This led to the development and importance of inland trade routes called Peruvali Chalai, connecting the places like Andhra Vadiga Peruvali, which connected up to Vizag, then Kongu Peruvali, it goes and then goes up to Kerala, also Karnataka, Rajasekari Peruvali, it is less. Rajakesari Peruvali, it connected Musiri, Kerala, maintained by the state and local administration. Villages were asked to give the labor free known as Vetti or Amanji for building and maintaining the roads. Once you go through it, you know how we all talk about so high, you will find out how they got things done by force. The width of these roads were 2 kolas, 24 feet. This 24 feet, I don't know, my town, where we were from Devakote and all those, exactly the road length was 24 feet, not 25 feet. This was about, when they did, even in 1960s, the road length was 24 feet.
Road width,
24 feet. My house was in the main road, just 24 feet the other side. Some of these things are very strange. Transport of goods were mostly by land only. Horse, bullock carts, donkeys, or headloads were the common modes. Waterway transport was rare. Merchants moved in groups from nagarams. This is called Vanigat Chattu. Merchants formed associations among themselves and framed their own MOUs and operated. Manigramam of Kodumbalur, Tiruparambiyam Valanjiyar, Teliki of Vijayawada, Satyavakkadar were few of the groups operated in inland trade. See, you say Satyavakka. These are the traders, they say what is most important them for them is their word. Trust. He has meant Satyavakka, they will never say lies. These associations provided capital, credit, insurance, warehousing to its members when in need. They acted as a liaison with the state and local authorities. Oil merchants formed a group as Sankarapadi. Weavers Association was known as Salia Nagaratta. These associations fixed the tax rate and got approved by the authorities. Most important, tax rates in the trading community were fixed by the traders themselves. They also ensured the remittance of taxes from members to the treasury. They collect the taxes on behalf of the each and everyone and collect it to the treasury. So the government did not interfere, especially in collection of taxes from trade. All types of artisans joined and formed a group to enhance their bargaining status. Kulothunga 1 period inscription mentions of artisans of different occasion joining together, forming an association called Radakkara. This group was allowed a separate flag. This group was also responsible for designing many Chola period artistic wonders, especially carpentry and all those things. These people have done a phenomenal work, it seems. Some of these Radakkara. Some of these associations had their own security guards to avert any raid while on movement and guard the stocks. The guards acted as the car drivers and helped to load and offload goods. They were called Munaivirar or Erivirar. As long as they were in the service of the association, they were treated as members. Manigramam of Kudumbalur in their later Chola period confined to inland trade as this became more lucrative and leaving the external to Nana Desi, who gained more acceptance and preference. Coming to external trades, 900 and 1300 CE saw the political stability in south, whereas the north was impounded with continuous raid from northwest, leading to contraction of economic growth. Indian Ocean had been the center of maritime activity, linking the west of India to the east of India up to China, and the southern kingdoms controlled the maritime trade. China was the imperial power of the eastern seas. All southeastern kingdoms, Srivijaya, Sailendra, that is Malaysia, Chams, Vietnam, Cambodia, that is Cambodia and Laos, acknowledged China's supremacy and sent regular embassies. Ships from China did not venture west beyond Kerala. Because of this, Tamil kingdoms could build up their good trading relations over the centuries. Trade with nations beyond the seas grew multifold during Chola times because of political stability that brought wealth to the treasury. Most importantly, the state, that is the king, fully supported them with charter, autonomy, and trade. The commercial contacts were with all South Asian nations, like Java, Sumatra, Srivijaya, Malaysia, Sailendra and Kedah, Thailand, Siam, Cambodia and Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam, Chams, and Sri Lanka. Access to China was through Malacca Straits. In 960 CE, the Song dynasty in China secured the control and promoted the trade with all. The list of products traded from Chola kingdom were too many. Important ones were cotton cloth, perfume, jewelry stones, ivory, rhino horns, resins, pearl, ruby, camphor, spices, etc. The Chinese government issued a fiat that certain articles imported from India to be traded only by government appointed agencies, and import duties were levied at 10 to 20%. This was collected in kind as products. Other than this, surcharge was levied on ship size and volume. Due to some trade imbalances, In mid-12th century, the Chinese government banned the export of some metals and exchange of coins with Cholas. It remains like Romans, you know, banned trading of giving of gold to Pandya kingdoms those days. The external throat cannot be discussed in isolation without bringing in body, in the body of the merchant guild, a mercantile corporation, Ainu Truer or Nana Desi. This origin is from Aihole of Badami, in existence in 7th century CE, comprising of mainly merchants who sailed to far off lands carrying merchandise, trade, and return back with goods. They became a force to reckon with in Chola times. Their business story is the story of Chola kingdom in the far off lands. Probably the first corporation of the world predating VOC and East India Company. Anjuvannam was another guild comprising of mainly foreign merchants like Arab Muslims, Jews, Christians, and Persians. I think this Anjuvannam may have come from the word Anjuman, which is a very common, you know, Persian and Arabic word. Guilds were formed to manage risks, that is physical dangers like attacks, piracy in foreign lands, provide information and communication on types of products to trade. Most important, these are types of product. This is what our export promotion councils do. These guilds were doing it. Products to trade, what quantum, where to sell, timing, provide logistical and infra support like the ships, scheduling of ships, warehousing facilities at the ports, and also transportation from port to the inland and from their place to the ports. Negotiate the terms of trade with the foreign government. Provide capital, credit, and insurance to the members. Liaise with the respective port authorities on tariffs. Most important, counsel traders to overcome cultural shocks wherever they go. One of the very important ones these guilds were doing. This is one of the reasons why members, once they become a member of the guild, generally they don't come out of the guild. And this is just to show what it was those days of how commerce was conducted all over Chola kingdom, including foreign lands. Whichever, you can see what it is. Very vast area.
This going all the way up to China happened only after Rajendra's war with Kadaram.
Before that, what had happened? These people used to go.
Yeah.
They give so it, they take
it. It was only this part.
This part.
You come and sell it to Srivijaya and Kadaram. And then go back.
No, no. China, what had happened? Till before that, they go with the China, but the Indonesian ship owners, they will be the lead. These people will go along with them. They were not recognized. Only after Rajendra Chola. Even Rajendra Chola time, it's so slowly it happened. After Rajendra Chola, they became a full-fledged Chinese people went. In fact, even after Lokanga during Pandya period, it seems a Muslim trader, he was leading the trade, guild from India to China. So all this intermingling have started from those days. Many inscriptions in foreign lands mention about Ainu Truer, Manigraman. Takuapa inscription in southern Thailand mentioned about Manigraman. 11th century inscription Barus in Sumatra and 13th century inscription in Pagan in Burma mention Ainu Truer, that is Nana Desi. Inscription in China mentions the Chola kings and the trade bodies. Rajaraja I, 1033, referred to as Losa, sent an embassy of pearls, ivory, and perfume. See, the perfume, ivory has been a very, very great demand in China. Rajendra I, 1033 CE, referred to as Chi Lo Lo Cha In Lo, sent the second embassy. Kulotunga I, referred to as Tihua, whatever it is, the third embassy. See, all these things happened within about 75-80 years. Peak. The ivory, the envoy, that is a member of the guild, carried, most important, Kulotunga time, glassware, camphor, incense, perfumes, ivory, rhino horns, spices, etc. in gifts. Rhino horns. See, this is what? This is aphrodisiac. So it happened only after Rajendra Chola went and conquered this Bengal, this one, it has started come. Earlier, I think it used to be, rhino horn used to go from Kalilas. Now, these people are very important, this one. And in return, here the most important, got a large quantity of copper. Copper, maximum Chola bronzes were started making after Rajendra Chola, Kulottanga Chola times. Copper is one of the very major this one. Earlier, they used to get copper from Indonesia. Now the copper, so this is a very, very important trading, this one. According to me, that's what I feel.
Yeah,
India does not
have
copper deposit. Copper deposit is, see, Rajendra Chola, I will come to you. Chotanagpur area, Orissa, Bihar, Bengal, all copper. And Rajendra Chola, I think one of the reason he went there, he found out a lot of copper, you know, supply, he would have arranged it. That could have been, this is a conjecture only. It could have. Similarly, Rajasthan is another very big copper, this one. Why Western Chalukyas were holding it? Some of the trading bodies, they would not have allowed to come from Rajasthan to this side. Probably this could have been one of the reasons also. Inscription 1079 AC at Taoist Monastery. This is another important one. Mentions a donation of 6 lakh gold coins by Kulottanga I. The Kulottanga I, it is mentioned, the Tihu Akiola gave. This is what it mentioned. 13th century inscription in Quanzhou, Canton, mentions about the building of a Shiva temple, Tirukkaniswaram, by Nana Desis, named after the ruler, the Tamil tradition. I think Kublai Khan was ruling it. These people got a good support from them in order to facilitate him. They built a Shiva temple named Shiva Tirukkaniswar.
Where did they build a Shiva temple?
Canton, Guangzhou. Even though it exists. So people who go to Guangzhou, please visit those temples. Nana Desi is engaged in importing many items, especially porcelain, Chinese yale, items of copper and tin, silk cloth, beads, etc. Items like porcelain, silk cloth were moved inland from Cholamandalam coast to western coast and exported to West Asia. This is where I, for me, why they should move inland when they have control even this, what is that war they won, the Kolachal and all, they were under them. Why can't they go at Kollam? Why did they move to Muzri and then export? Probably the Arab traded the ships. They are more comfortable with dealing with Muzris than the southern coast. Maybe it could be the reason. Rajendra I led the naval campaign against Sailendra Kingdom in Kedah to protect the trading interests of Tamil merchants. About 12 inscriptions in Tamil dating to 1100 to 1300 CE were discovered in Sri Lanka referring to Ainu Truer Nana Desi. These merchant groups settled in many ports of those countries, and cultural similarities provided stable and better relationships with the locals. In many cases, they took active participation in creating public facilities. Nana Desi survived and preserved their trade for many centuries in spite of changing political climate. In fact, I read somewhere in Vietnam, Chams, there's a group of, Nagaratas who went and settled in 12th century, still their descendants are still living in Vietnam. They are thoroughly changed, but the features will be entirely different from what you find in the Vietnamese and then these people. To facilitate the export, port facilities were improved. Exports happened from Nagapattinam, Sadurangapattinam, Marakkalam, Krishnapattinam, Palaverkadu, Kodiyakadu, Tirumailai, Kottapattinam, that is near Sriharikota, Vishakapattinam, which was renamed as Kulottanga Cholapattinam, Motupalli, Kollam, Muzri, Machilipattinam, and many more. Krishnapattinam is there. It is there. It is there. It is there. It is a port. It's an old port. Pulikat only Palaverkadu. Pulikat is Palaverkadu. Sir, Yakka Chak. Mr. Narasaya has given so many number about everything. He has given so, man is amazing, you know, information. Mylapore. Mylapore was a port. Before Portuguese took over, it was a port. Chola period was a port. Manadesis had own warehouses in these ports. The state took care to connect all these ports to inland towns and capital by Peruvai Chalai. Manadesis had their own soldiers, army, who acted as sailors also. Here, I just digress. It's totally unconnected. One of our local Tamil historian, Mr. Venkatesh, he wrote a novel sequel to Ponniyin Selvan called Kaveri and Mani. There an incident comes where a Nagarathar Meyyappan is a port sailor to assist Arulmozhi Verman. His ship was, you know, confiscated, but the pirates take over the ship and these people fight and recover the ship. Where he mentions, so the sailors were also soldiers, probably it existed, very just connecting nothing to his, one cannot prove it, but it was a very interesting incident. Nanadesis were treated special by the state and the administration. Areas were given to them for settlements in towns and capitals. They created associations called Nagaram. This Nagaram is different from the town Nagaram, civil administration. This Nagaram is a different set organization, which in turn effectively functioned as the outsourcing agency to the state and local bodies in administration. This Nagaram is different from towns. Nanadesis got themselves associated with temples with large donations. Many grew in stature and slowly over the centuries became trustees of the temples. As the commerce grew, the influence of the merchant class also grew. Chidambaram temple attained a preeminent position in Chola period, and the part played by the merchant class can't be ignored. Then, yep, an arm of commerce, banking. Temples were the prominent bankers. The sabhas or nagarams, which had the mandate to run the affairs of the temple, lent money to the needy, charging interest. The interest rates varied from 12.5% to 37.5%. Sometimes it went even to 53% still. Especially Rajaraja III, Rajendra, the last period, it went to even 53% it seems. The practice of issuing IOU was in force. Thiruvavadudurai?
Not really. The interest rate has a lot to do with the growth and inflation. So 12.5%, if there was a lot of growth happening, 12.5%.
It's very normal.
Not bad at all, or even 30%.
Thiruvavadudurai inscription of Rajaraja I period mentions the receipt of IOU, Kayyeluthu Olai. There have been provisions to confiscate properties in case of non-payment of interest and loan. However, there were no evidence. However, there were no evidences available in recordings of the individual transactions among the merchants, and terms were not known. Similarly, individuals, what went around the loan, this thing, it is not there. All these things about one sabha giving to the another sabha, or one merchant associate giving, taking from the temple, this is what it is. Individuals, it is not showing. I think only B2B only recorded. Let me put it, only B2B is recorded. B2C, nothing, no news about B2C. The next one is the taxes, revenue. Temple developed a dominant and integrative institution. Assemblies of villages or towns or nagarams, sabhas along with the temples, became the nodal points in revenue administration. Here, there is a difference between, you know, sabhas. The sabhas mainly belong to Brahmadevas, where the Chaturvedi Mangala, where the large population of Brahmins were settled, and they had their own assembly that is called sabhas. Revenue for the kingdom were one from land, two from trade. Donations and endowments and collection from tributaries were the other sources. Chola administration was decentralized to a large extent, and the revenue collection was outsourced to a large extent to the local bodies, thus minimizing the strain on the state. Villages are an assembly called Oor, Brahmadeyams they are Sabhas, towns they are Nagarams. This is the crux of the Chola administration. All tax-paying residents were the members of the respective Oor, Sabha, Nagaram. We talk about Uttaramirur, the Sabha, Anganadandala. Sabha member on first criterion, you should be a taxpayer. The second one, the rest of the things follow. That means, except the lower level or whatever we call in the Tavara, everybody was taxed in the Chola period. Nagaram had authority over surrounding small villages. Land tax was the major revenue for the state. Taxation was based on customary and tacit approval by the assemblies. Land tax was, I was wondering what is this tacit approval by the assemblies. Suppose you change tacit approval, the assemblies decide. Suppose the king says, I want more, the assemblies decide. All these members also agree because everybody is a taxpayer. So how it is, how they manage it, still it's a big question mark. But the tacit approval by the assemblies is one of the important works here. Land tax was collected in a mix of cash and kind, that is the produce. Land was possessed by individuals, assemblies or sabhas, or nagarams and temples. Rajaraja I initiated an elaborate land survey assessment in 1000 CE, recording measurements, ownership rights in government records. This included both agricultural wet and dry and residential lands. Kulothunga I undertook the survey again in his reign. Most important, Kulothunga did it around 1076, around that period. He came in this one, 1080 something. Incidentally, William the Conqueror, same 1070 around, he also conducted a very major land survey when he won the Britain from Normandy, became the king. So, same this, one of the important ones, he also undertook a very big land survey. I don't think anywhere else, I never read anywhere else in even European history also any of this land survey has been done except the William King, William the Conqueror. The state share was fixed, 1/3 of the produce based on records. The quantum of tax value varied on the nature of the land assessed, like wet or dry. The local bodies too levied additional taxes to cover the administrative costs. 1/3 for the king. Adhikku mela administration in the vetti paathukonu idella solranga illaya, so andha oor sabha iruma, that is why it comes around 45-50 varum
avlo
illa adha varudilla, average it comes around 45%. If the king was very good, like Rajaraja period, Kulothunga one period, it was around 30. The last one, Rajaraja 3 and then Rajendra 3, it went up to 45-48%. Land tax was the major revenue for the state. Taxation was based on, the local bodies too levied additional taxes to cover the administrative costs. The local tax thus recovered varied from, total tax thus recovered varied from 33% to 45% in different periods. They say the 45% was the common, this one, even in Mughal times, even after Maratha, Vijayanagar period also, they say 45% was the common all over India. The land tax comprised of tax on produce, cultivator, that is the professional tax, water tax and other cess like distilling tax, distilling tanks and lakes, tax on houses and buildings. Sungam was collected on all goods on transit on highways. Taxes were levied on shops and goods traded either by weight or volume. Profession tax on merchants, all categories of artisans, oilmongers, shepherds, washermen, fishermen, etc. Even fishermen have to pay tax. All manufactured products were taxed. Taxes thus collected, this is the most important, very this is the most important one. Taxes thus collected, net of all expenses, like salaries of officials and other employees of the state and military and other administrative costs, were remitted to the treasury under the supervision of Nadu and Mandalam officials. All official expenses, taxes, everything were deducted from the total taxes collected, and the official, then it was remitted to the state treasury. Like companies pay the contract workers, deduct, same thing it happens here. The other taxes collected were, this is very, 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 interesting one. The compulsory tax called VETI, sort of labor tax. Special purpose tax. Alangudi records say that Veera Rajendra levied a special tax to finance war efforts against Vengi. Taxes were mentioned in many terms like Irai, Ayam, Kudimai, Urvaripadu, Tandam, Iravu, Puravu, etc. Taxes levied by the king or the state were clubbed under Kudimai and the assembly Sabha Nagaram under Urvaripadu. Iraili denotes the exempted category. Tandam denoted the penalty levied. Rajaraja III, that is 1249 C inscription, mentions Asivaga Kasi, a cess levied on Asivagas. So Asivagas were taxed, something like a jizya tax.
By the period, probably they were non-existent.
What question is that? For sure.
Might mean something else also.
Asivaga Kasi. Nilakanta Sastri specifically mentions this.
Who is
Ajivikas.
Ajivikas. Ajivikas. That is a
separate religious
sect. Jaini somebody. The other taxes collected were Eri Eevu, that is tax on lakes, Vedanai, compulsory labor, Maranjavadi, tax on trees, Kidakasu, tax on cattle. Also, taxes were collected on the occasion of festivals and public functions as Urkadanji or Atrupattam. Suppose a town celebrates a temple festival. Whoever comes, they have to pay tax, like entry tax, what we have. However, these were rare and levied by specific local assembly. Throughout Chola period, Padikaval Kuli, that is local policing, was compulsorily collected from all the village and town people. So the policing was done by only the local assemblies, and everybody has to pay this. Probably the higher body, whatever party comes, party count. A strange custom in Kulottunga one period, 1303, shepherds of Thiruvaipadi Nadu were directed to offer a sheep to the Vishnu temple, Jalasayam, Vishnu temple at Jalasayam near Karur, on the occasion of nuptials of their sons and daughters sitting families, that is Kanavan Veedu Bhuda. They were peculiar, and it was there for quite some time, it seems. Periodic survey of lands were done and tax was assessed. Changes were incorporated in the records. Use of force was recorded to collect dues if not paid. Kings did not interfere. When the appeal was made to the king, Rajaraja I, contesting the assessments, the king returned filed to the assembly and the official. Most important, here the state never interfered with the tax officials in their duty of collecting the taxes. What they say, the state accepted. There is, I don't think any, overrunning was there, reviewing the petition, all, nothing was there.
Local dadagiri is both perfect.
No, but assemblies control also, they do it, but assemblies control.
It's all,
dadagiri, dadagiri, local distance, what they decide. That is when a tacit approval is there. So what they decide, everybody has to accept.
To keep the king in good humor, he can do
That's what it is. Defaulters were punished harshly, confiscating property and recovering dues from sale proceeds. Overdue amounts were collected with interest. Most of the inscriptions mentioned about the omissions of the wealthy and the fines collected. Even temples did not escape. Inscription in Saluvakuppam dated 1215 CE mentions the sale of temple land to meet the revenue dues of the state. See, this is what the temple has lands under them. They will lease it out. They have to collect and give it to the this one. The temple failed. So the temp, whatever the lands they had, they sold it and collected the dues. So most important, this is the one. Here it is there, you know. Most of the institutions mentioned about the omissions of the wealthy and then the sabhas, assemblies and temples. Individuals, small, this one, nothing is mentioned. There is no mention of about individuals. Officials were punished only when they misappropriated money or defrauded the system. When the central authority weakened, the officials of local chieftains and feudatories went out of control. That resulted in oppressive tax regime. Mannargudi Sabai, that is 1238-39, Kalvattu Kuruvadu. Palarum Kaivandavadi, Tandikkuhayale, Engalukkum Taripadillaye, indicating the drain, probably Dadi Eduthavan Tandalkaran, proven correct there. Whenever the system turned oppressive, people migrated to other places. Rajaraja III and Rajendra III period, 1220-1275, saw the decline of Chola power and consequently the area under shrunk. Revenue contracted, oppression increased. The end of the Chola power was near. So next we'll come to the legal tenders of coins. In a matter of conjecture, to fix the size or volume of money economy in Chola times as taxes, taxes that were collected both in kind and cash money. Many inscriptions also mention that donations were made in money. Gold and silver coins were introduced widely as money, that is the medium of exchange, indicating the prosperity, growth, urbanization, higher level of economic development. A coin is a piece of metal having a definite shape and weight with symbols embossed. It's a legal tender instituted by the state. Gold, silver, copper coins were circulated with specific weight and purity content of the metal with different denominations. Kayanju and Kasu were the denominations in circulation in gold coins. Manjadi, Kundri, Thiramam were lower denominations used in different periods. They were one Kayanju equal to 2 Kasu, 8 Manjadi equal to 1 Kasu, Thiramam is equal to 1 Kasu. இதெல்லாம் எனக்கு தெரியாது, நான் இப்ப படிச்ச அப்புறம் தான் தெரியும். So I'm still I am not able to comprehend what it is. கழஞ்சி காசு கேட்டிருக்கு, இந்த திரமம் இதெல்லாம் இருக்கு இல்லையா? இந்த ஃபர்ஸ்ட் டைம் ஐ அம் ஒன்லி ஆஃப்டர் ரீடிங் தோஸ் டைம் ஒன்லி ஐ கேம் டு நோ திஸ் ஒன். ஒன் மஞ்சாடி இஸ் ஈக்வல் டு 2 குன்றி. அதர் தேன் தி அபவ், ஈழக்காசு, ஈழக் கருங்காசு, அக்கம் வேர் ஆல்சோ இன் யூஸ். த ஈக்குவலன்ஸ் வேர் ஒரு ஈழக்காசு இஸ் அக்கம், இதெல்லாம் பார்த்தது. திஸ் இஸ் த மோஸ்ட் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். Weight of one kalanju, they said it is about 80 grains of paddy. Paddy will be a normally, the size will be the normal, common one, whatever be the 80 grains. One kalanju was also known as madai. Ilakasi is half madai. Purity of gold used is the highest in ilakasi. Cholas made ilakasi as the standard for their coins too. Kalanju was known as pun also. All donations mentioned Thulaipon, Sembon, indicating gold of best purity. Every ruler added his name or title to the madai when he introduced madai. Kalanju and Kasu in early Chola times were in pure gold. However, the purity of gold went down during the later Cholas. In Kulottunga I's 10th year inscription mentions the exchange rates between gold and silver coins. 100 Kasu gold is equal to 433 kalanju weight of silver. So, one kalanju gold is 8.66 kalanjus of silver. Kasu terminology was used copper coins also from Kulottunga one time. There were many measures and tools to ascertain the purity and weight of gold. Rajaraja once time, Adavallan Kal, Tachinam Vedivilangan Kal, were used to ascertain the purity and weight of the item, like கல்ல தேப்பாங்களோ உரகல் ஆடவல்லாங்கள். இந்த காயின் இன்ஸ்கிரிப்ஷன்ஸ் வர் இன் தமிழ், தமிழ் கிரந்தா அண்ட் தேவநாகரி. இங்கிலீஷ்ல போட்டது தட்சிண மேடு விலங்கன் தான் போட்டிருக்கலாம். தட்சிண மேரு விடங்கன் விடங்கன் வரணும் இல்லையா. தட்சிண The coins used by different kings in their time had continuity and their individuality. All contained their symbol, tiger, with other motifs depending on situations. Below we see the Uttama Chola coin. Uttama Chola coins, a seated tiger, two fish and a bow on a pedestal with a parasol and two chamaras above the oversight on the reverse side, obverse side on the reverse side. Written Uttama Cholas in Nagari letters. These are all taken from manuscript museum, linguistic memory. Tiger okandirukku, rendu fish anga idu vera irukku. Inge pinnadi vandu idu
ராஜராஜா ஒன் பீரியட் தி காயின்ஸ் வர் இன் சர்க்குலேஷன் ஃபார் மெனி சென்ச்சுரிஸ்.
Many types of coins were issued. Common one was a seated king with a raised right arm, written Sri Rajaraja in Nagari. On the reverse side, a standing king with flower and spears hanging. This is Rajaraja coin. I think this particular coin continued till the end of Chola Empire. Everybody used the same, this one. Minted the same. This is a gold coin.
We had a
ராஜேந்திர சோழா ஒன் இஷ்யூட் காயின்ஸ் தட் ஆர் டைகர். இங்க பாருங்க ராஜேந்திர சோழா, இதுல பாருங்க டைகர், ஃபிஷ், போ அண்ட் அ லாம்ப் வித் தி லெஜெண்ட் அந்த கோடியில போ அண்ட் அந்த When Gangai Konda Chola in Nagari script on both sides, Sri Rajendra, Mummudi Konda Chola, Uddamalla were also in the other legends inscribed. Rajadi Raja as a co-regent issued a coin with legend of Malayanadu Konda. Bottom one is the Kulothunga Chola coin. That is not very clear. Kulothunga one period coins had the figure of two fish, a seated tiger, a bow, two lamp stands in the center. Malayanadu Konda Cholan inscribed in tamil. It looks like coins were issued from Kanchi and Nellore also, with Kanchi and Ne inscribed, probably indicating the minting done in those places. Other kings followed Kulothunga one might have minted their own coins. However, no evidence so far. Continued with the established designs. However, there was clearly a degradation in the purity of the metals. Hoarding was the pastime of people, and people might have hoarded and converted them into ornamental goods. Revenues were also collected in kind and in that is producing grains. Nari, Marakkal, Kuruni, Kalam were the measures followed. However, these measures varied under different rulers. Aalaku, Uri, Padi were the measures used for liquids. Aadu was another term used to measure liquid equivalent, one padi, G. Now finally, we'll come to the laws and jurisprudence. For administering the laws, Cholas followed the traditional system. Dharmasastra was the reference. The distinction between civil and criminal offenses did not exist. Some acts were considered as crimes against public. Legislation of laws and dispensation of justice were under the authority of the local assemblies. No separate or exclusive setup to enact laws. Major disputes among the constituent assemblies of trade bodies, merchants, artisans were settled by the respective bodies. Assembly, wherever, if it is in the assembly, this one, the assembly settles. If it is with the, you know, Sabha, this one, the Sabha settles. If it happens in Nagaram, the Nagaram group settles it. A specific group called Nyayatar. This is the most important one. Nyayatar was constituted in all assemblies or sabhas to look into the disputes and pronounce verdicts and enforce execution. At the central level, the king was ultimate authority, heading the judicial body known as Dharmasanam, ably assisted by a body of citizens well versed in Dharma Shastras called Dharmasana Pattakal. See, the generally anything is there, all most of the things, there was always confiscation of property or penalty. This you know, very rare giving a corporal punishment. Very, very rare. Even Rajaraja, even Rajadram, Rajaraja one, whoever the people who killed his elder brother, he only confiscated the property. He said they allowed, they, you know, ostracized them, not participating in anything. No corporal punishments were very, very, not, no records. Very rare, very rare. Not many references to methodology of judicial records and documents. Documentation of Sundaramurthy Nayana's case in Sekila's Periyapuranam is a pointer to the procedures followed in Kulothunga II time. The admissible evidences were original written documents. These are most important, sir. The admissible evidence were original written documents. Eyewitness established the case. The court official oversees the procedure was called Karanathan. Sir, you are getting left. The court official is called Karanathan. He was also the accountant of the assembly. He was also the judicial authority. Kanakupulla, judicial authority, court official, is the court official. Only those unresolved disputes. This is another very important one, how our present governments operate. Only those unresolved disputes of the assembly court, court were appealed to the higher Nadu, which come under the king's authority. Ruling was always tried to be non-partisan. So they are the enforcer of law. This is very important. Sir, this is one mukhyamana oru ruling was getting. Ruling was always tried to be non-partisan. Settlements among the litigants were the order of the day mostly. Settlements are where enga punishment irukku. All villages had registration offices, record rooms, keeping documents of ownership, sale deed, exemption decrees, etc. Nagasami sir, romba alaga or article illa. Eppadi every village government had a separate place to keep records, how they keep the records ella eliyirukanga. Appa enakku or doubt undadhu. The records in ellil eliyirupanga, probably olayilaya. But I heard India la paper making had come in 11th century itself.
என்ன
போட்டிருக்காரு, ஒரு கிங் கொடுத்தது, அடுத்த நாலு மூணு ஜென்ரேஷன் 100 வருஷம் கழிச்சோம் தேவ தி ஃபேமிலிஸ் ஆர் என்ஜாயிங் தி பெனிஃபிட். ஓலையில் எழுதினா ஓலை 150 வருஷம் இருக்குமா? ப்ராப்ளி காப்பி பண்ணானா இருக்குது. அதுல வந்து கையெழுத்து போடுவாங்க, இதை நான் எழுதினேன்னு கையெழுத்து போடுவாங்க. காப்பி பண்ணும்போது எப்படி கையெழுத்து போட முடியும்?
இல்ல அந்த கையெழுத்திருக்காது பட் பைடன் அந்த அப்படி இருந்ததை நான் காப்பி பண்ணிருக்கேன் அப்படின்னு போட்டு
காப்பி பண்ணாலும் இவர் காப்பி பண்ண இதுக்கு ரெண்டு மூணு சாட்சிகள் All villages at registration offices record rooms, keeping documents of ownership, sale deed, exemption, decrees, etc. நாகசாமி சார் ரொம்ப அழகா எழுதியிருக்காங்க. ஒவ்வொரு வில்ல என்ன இது இருக்கு எப்படி பண்ணாங்கன்னு வெரி ரிவீலிங். The following documents are accepted as legal. Vilai, Nila Vilai, Bhoomi, Chandeswaram, that is Mannar Peril Kudukkaradhu, Aasiriya, Adaikkalam, Irai Kaavar, Surety for Tax, Isaivu Cheetu, Agreement between Concerned Parties.
Isaivu Cheetu.
Isaivu, huh?
Spelling mistake.
Illa, Isaivu Cheetu, Nana Ardhan Nanachay, Isaivu Cheetu Thaam Pottru Thaam. Isaivu Cheetu Thaam Pottru Thaam. இறைக்காவல் ஓட்டோலை சூரிட்டி ஃபார் அட்வான்ஸ் டாக்ஸ் பொருள் மாவிருதி பொருட்டோலை இன் பிக்சிங் பிரைஸ் அண்ட் லிமிட்டிங் எக்ஸ்பென்சஸ் தட் இஸ் ஒரு இது பண்றீங்க நம்ம கான்ட்ராக்ட் போடல இவ்வளவுதான் எக்ஸ்பென்ஸ் இதுக்கு மேல போனா யாரு பேர் பண்ண இதெல்லாம் அமேசிங் வாட் வி ஆர் டூயிங் நவ் ஆல் தீஸ் திங்ஸ் ஆர் இன் எக்ஸிஸ்டன்ஸ் தோஸ் டேஸ் வெரி அமேசிங் டாக்குமெண்டேஷன் மேண்டேட்டரி ஃபார் பார்ட்டிஸ் கன்சர்ன் டு புட் தியர் சிக்னேச்சர்ஸ் ஆஸ் இவை என் எழுத்து அண்ட் த விட்னஸ் ஆஸ் இப்படி அறிவேன் டாக்குமெண்ட் ரைட்டர் அண்ட் ஊர்கணக்கார் சார் ஊர்கணக்கார் அவர் அக்கௌண்டன்ட் ஊர்கணக்கார் ஊர்கணக்கார் ஆல்சோ ஹாவ் டு அஃபிக்ஸ் தியர் சிக்னேச்சர்ஸ் Confiscation of the property was the norm in criminal acts against public interests. அதெல்லாம் ஒன்னும் போடல அதெல்லாம் ஒன்னும் நாலந்தாவே can suggest நாலந்தாவே can suggest a course இல்ல அதெல்லாம் ஒண்ணுமே இல்ல தர்மசாஸ்திரம் தான் போட்டிருக்காங்களே தவிர வேற எதுவுமே போடல அதெல்லாம் ஒன்னும் இதுவே இல்லை ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் இது எதுவுமே நத்திங் இஸ் மென்ஷன் நான் படித்த இது எந்த எந்த ரெஃபரன்ஸும் அது மாதிரி மென்ஷனே பண்ணல தெரியல சுத்தமாக ஐ நோ ஐடியா கான்ஃபிஸ்கேஷன் ஆஃப் ப்ராப்பர்ட்டி வாஸ் த நார்ம் இன் கிரிமினல் ஆக்ட்ஸ் அகேன்ஸ்ட் பப்ளிக் இன்ட்ரெஸ்ட் மிஸ்அப்ராப்ரியேஷன் தெஃப்ட் ஆஃப் டெம்பிள் ப்ராப்பர்ட்டி ஃபெல் அண்டர் திஸ் லா சம் டிஸ்பியூட்ஸ் மோஸ்ட் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் சம் டிஸ்பியூட்ஸ் வேர் அலவுட் டு லிங்கர் ஃபார் லாங் Generally, this happens if the dispute was between assemblies and sabhas. Government, in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, dispute abadi porudhu paringa. Offenses against the king, royalty considered as Rajadroham, were dealt directly by the king himself. Rajaraja I had decreed to confiscate the properties of those who conspired and killed his elder brother Aditya II. This is called Agnyakriyamaha. This type of penalty, this one, justice is called Agnyakriyamaha. Forgery, theft and adultery were considered a serious crime. Stiff fines, revocation of their rights to participate in the assembly proceedings, etc. were handed over. Even in the case of murder, the act was pardoned if the affected family agrees. வெஸ்டர்ன் கண்ட்ரீஸ்ல இருக்கு இல்ல இது அரப் கண்ட்ரீஸ்ல இருக்கு இல்லையா பிளட் மணி இஃப் யூ கிவ் பிளட் மணி இட் இஸ் எக்ஸம்ப்ட் இன் மெனி ஆஃப் தி மர்டர் இன்சிடென்ட்ஸ் விச் ஹேப்பன் அன்எக்ஸ்பெக்டட்லி ஆர் டியூ டு த ஹீட் ஆஃப் த மூமெண்ட் தி கல்பிரிட் வாஸ் லெட் ஆஃப் டு டூ த பப்ளிக் சேவா இன் த டெம்பிள் தட் மீன்ஸ் ஹீ சேஸ் ஹி ஹஸ் டு கிவ் அ சாசனம் போல இருக்கு அந்த கோவிலுக்கு நான் அடிமையாகிறேன் என்னுடைய சந்ததிகளும் அடிமையாக இருப்பார்கள்னு எழுதி கொடுக்கணுமா தட் இஸ் ஹவ் தி பனிஷ்மெண்ட் வாஸ் ஹேண்டட் ஓவர் theft of cattle was the most common occurrence. If the Devadana cattle or the temple property were stolen, the culprit's property was confiscated. Otherwise, imposing fines were the common decrees. Inga da first time I saw a common man fined ingiradhu idhula da varudhe thavara micha endha idhiliyum or common man ku enna irukumo there is no record, no mention. Only Devadana property or assembly property or temple property or edhuva irundha or governmental property, anything is there, all records are there. If the court finds the crime unpardonable, very rare, lashings and decapitation were handed over in extreme cases. Now finally, observations and conclusions. Urbanization in south of India started earnestly with Cholas. Result, Tamil Nadu even today the most urbanized state. Cholas were ruthless in war. Treatment of POWs were harsh. Influx of war prisoners might have helped Rajaraja I and Rajendra I to converting unmanned lands to irrigation. That is, got the free labor. Encouraging skilled groups to settle in Tamilagam might have been the seed to develop manufacturing clusters, especially in textiles and foundry, the leading player in India today. Probably the first dynasty, it's a question mark, in the medieval India to formalize anointing the successor, the progeny from a daughter. Control over Raichur Dor, the triangular area between Krishna and Tungabhadra, rich in iron ore deposits, helped the war efforts. I always wonder why Chola always fought with Western Chalukyas. Western Chalukyas were there in that particular one where we have Raichur, Hastad, Bellary. Very rich in this one, probably the access. Our Tamil Nadu never had iron deposits. Not even this one. Gold also, more than Kolar, there it was called Hakur or something near Raichur. That was the first gold mine in India. Probably because of this, there is no mention, probably this could be the reason. Always fought with Western Chalukyas. There is no document, nothing is there. Did metal crafts reach peak in Chola due to acquiring control over Chota Nagpur area rich in copper?
Even before the imperial Chola period, Sibian Madhavi period, copper works on Arya, bronzes, Arya Aranjit. But with Rajarajan period, it increases in number dramatically. Their ability to, for example, Vidya Rehija says, probably because of procuring it from Edom, copper from Edom. So they were figuring out sources.
I'm not saying it. See, copper used to come, like Indonesia. This is major copper supply even today. They used to get from Indonesia. Rajasthan is a copper supply, will be there. What I am trying to say, the amount of bronzes made after Kulothunga Rajendra Roy increased phenomenally. Probably the supply one only, whatever it is, the supply could have, they would have a better supply. All recordings were about institutions, royalty, wealthy, but not much info about common folks. Probably they were not paying taxes, so excluded from records. Were there any technological advance in weaponry that helped them? No idea. Why did Chola fail to overcome Western Chalukyas? This is always a question whenever you read Chola history. Why they couldn't go beyond west to this one? Kalinga and Bengal region has been historically the most wealthy of the subcontinent. Mauryas, Guptas, Krishnadevaraya, Mughals, Marathas, British all enjoyed the wealth from this area. Cholas too. Economy indeed boomed. Gangaikonda Cholapuram remained a capital for almost 240 years. should have been an elegant city as big as Kanchi. Yet Pandya's rage and fury saw the city turn to dust with no visible remnants. Sad, the Tamils in war, even against their own, were ruled more by rage and ego than by tact and goodwill. Yet the economic clusters developed in Chola times survived the changes and continued till modernity in some forms. Thank you.
See, again, that